think it was implied that the event is going to be in English. And I'm not sure if Katerina is going to respond in English.
Yeah.
Probably that will be okay. What I'm going to do is, first thing, I'm just going to say a couple of words. Of course, you know, everybody says that this is a text which is taken out from the context of a larger work, which is my doctoral project. And it's actually something that comes from in the later stages of what I do. So right now I've been working for the last 1 month and something on a text that you don't know, but Katerina knows better. And what I'm going to present is not the text in itself, but some highlights taken out of it, and trying to focus on some of the segments and kind of try to flesh out some consequences of the problem. And the problem that I identify is called Problem of Disembodiment. And this problem is sets the tone of my entire project, but right now I'm going to speak about it from the perspective of feminist poststructuralist philosophy. In general, my interest in the topic comes from work on theoristic matter. Theoristic matter are closely related to cosmological theories, but what I mean by that is ancient cosmological theories mostly. And in the contemporary figurations of this problematic, I'm interested in so-called speculative philosophy. Before I proceed, I want to just focus down a little bit on what is the problem of disembodiment, and in what particular theoretical fields deal with it, in my opinion. And later on, I will discuss the work of Katerina Kolozova and the work of Madhavi Menon. And then I will try to, so this is the part that actually Katerina Kolozova doesn't know. So this is the only part that you are not prepared for, because I added it up later. So maybe that will be a little element of surprise for you in the whole framework. Let me clarify what is the problem of disembodiment. The problem of disembodiment, as identified in my project, is sort of millennial, centuries-long motif in first mythological and then philosophical thinking. It is extremely difficult to translate it in extremely difficult to translate it into contemporary speculative philosophy, for the simple reason that contemporary speculative philosophy is influenced by something which is called non-philosophy. And this is a brainchild of philosophical reason, but it's not a practice of doing philosophy per se. So to figure and explain a big curve from mythological thinking, which is basically as far as 6th century BC, to contemporary 21st non-philosophy, and to speak about the problem of disembodiment there, you have to go through really a lot of authorities. I'm not going to do that. I'm just giving you the context of the ramifications of the problem of disembodiment. And in my opinion, the problem of disembodiment consists in something that not me, a lot of feminist philosophers mostly have identified as the problem of male self-sufficiency and the fantasy of auto-protection of the cosmos from an authorial philosophical male position within the domain of reason, within the domain of practicing philosophical reason. And this is something that has been highlighted in contemporary philosophy since the 1970s by people who subscribe to the label feminist philosophy. So what has happened since the 1970s onwards is a particular philosophical obsession with the notion of embodiment. So now I have to explain the dynamics that I see between embodiment and disembodiment. right, in order to proceed. What is called feminist philosophy is invested in the history of embodiment, because it's engaged with a philosophical practice of exposing the complacency of philosophical reasoning as a particularist version of reasoning that is very often called mainstream instead of mainstream philosophy. And that particular obsession has created certain problems as well as numerous brilliant analysis of the history of so what happens today with the advent of so-called, I will use the generic term speculative philosophies. What happens today is that there is a serious problem in working with the legacy of feminist philosophy and feminist poststructuralism in a context that is not particularizing, in a context which tries to speak about theories of subjectivities and also production of social subjectivities that on the one hand reproduce and respect the legacies of feminist philosophy and feminist poststructuralism, but on the other hand try to break away from philosophies of particularist reasoning that are to a larger extent grounded on a notion of embodiment. So the notion of embodiment serves as a conceptual, if you will, invisible grid of doing poststructuralist philosophy. This is one of the working claims that I have. And there is also, in light of this, there is also a distinction that should be made between feminist philosophy and feminist poststructuralism. Feminist poststructuralism is a form of doing feminist theory, to use a more generic term, that doesn't necessarily have a pragmatic political purpose. It doesn't mean it's not politicizable, it means that feminist poststructuralist philosophy is interested in producing theories that explain the constitution of mostly female subjectivities, or so-called others. Not all of feminist philosophers who identify as such would subscribe to feminist poststructuralism, and I make a distinction to just make sure that these are two different strands of thought. And in the text that I, that Katerina Kolozova knows, that she has gone through, I sent previously, I developed more on this point, so if probably there is something interesting in the distinction, we can go there. So, I just wanted to say that there are particular, there is one particular problem with what I call the problem of disembodiment. And I think it's happening and it's becoming visible with the advent of an influence of Francois Laruelle's philosophy, the way it has been taken up in so-called speculative or neorealism. And consequently in other fields, such as object-oriented philosophy or object-oriented ontology. And I think that what happens is the following. From the 1970s onwards, there are numerous examples in the history of contemporary feminist philosophies and feminist poststructuralisms that denounce the idea that there is a point of view that is universal. And that also attaches itself to any notion of universal human subject. So, to put it bluntly, there is no point of nowhere from which we can speak about subjectivity. There is always a situated perspective. And this vocabulary is taken from Donna Haraway, mostly in her seminal texts that deal with situated knowledges, as well as Sandra Harding and a couple of other very influential writers. Who have contributed to this debate. So what happens with the problem of disembodiment from my point of view now is that it starts to figure out again in a way that threatens people who identify as feminist poststructuralists or feminist philosophers. And a bit later I will explain what I think Katerina Kolozova is doing regarding this problem, but also it would be interesting to see whether she actually identifies or has felt it, this problem is reappearing under what she does. So just briefly again, there are several fields such as speculative realism, new realism, object-oriented ontology, that are not necessarily allergic to the particularism and the point of situated knowledge promoted by feminist thinkers. This is, I have to say that this there is a tendency recently for some people who have a strong access to identification with these fields to denounce the work of the people that I just mentioned from the people from the fields that I just mentioned. There is a tendency, including Rosie Braidotti, who is the mouthpiece of some of these philosophers, to claim that these are people who are undereducated in feminist theory, which is, I think, not true. And I'm going to remain silent as to, I have an opinion, but I'm not going to say it now, as to why people like Braidotti would say, would make such claims. But I find it highly problematical because the people who engage with a universalistic point of view on the matters of subjectivity, they are not undereducated in feminist theory, on the contrary. So I think that there should be a more balanced view. But it doesn't mean, again, it doesn't mean that they don't resuscitate what I call the problem of disembodiment. And maybe just to try to recapture this part from the presentation again, because I actually just realized that I told I'm going to read, but I'm not. Just to try to recapture this again, I think to recapture the problem of disembodiment, it concerns the philosophical equalization between what is a given subject, what is subjectivity, and maleness, the category of maleness. So this is nothing original, this is a very old problem, it has been studied in classics, it has been studied in feminist philosophy, in analytic philosophy, in numerous fields. And it has a very strong history that is identified with Plato and Platonism. And there are several crucial concepts which I'm going to mention. And one of them is the notion of the one, which comes from Plato's written doctrine. This is actually something that I deal with in the earlier phase of my doctoral project, which is first part is about mythology and Plato, second part is about New Platonism, and the third part is about feminist poststructuralism. So again, the problem of disembodiment figures in this entire trajectory, which is really too huge to explain, but my focus is on the third part today, which is a little bit weird even for me because I actually haven't produced the middle part. I have two chapters, but I haven't produced the middle part with the Neoplatonic philosophers, which is probably going to be the heart of my study. So again, there are some vivid, quite emotional reactions against the promotion of a universalist point of view, which is labeled as the point of as the view from nowhere, rather than the view from somewhere, which is to say a situated perspective of speaking and knowing the reality. These reactions come from people like Rosie Braidotti and Isabel Stengers, and etc. The question for me is what can be changed from contemporary perspective when it comes to resuscitating the problem of disembodiment, if I am correct to identify it as such. I will now discuss disembodiment from the perspective of Laruelle, and from the perspective of Katerina Kolozova, and how she productively enmeshes his philosophy in feminist theory. Here I'm going to resort to reading, which is part of the work I have done so far. But before I continue, maybe just a couple of notes on the reception of Kolozova so far. In the text that I produced and that I sent to her, I made a very large, rather lengthy point about how what she has written and published so far has been oddly, until recently, right now I don't think this is the case, but until recently what she was doing was oddly marginalized. There is even an instance where a friend of ours said that she has been forgotten, but that was really funny because she hasn't been remembered in the circles of philosophers who deal with speculative realism, etc., etc. So, and the one person who did mention her in founding ontology of the speculative term, it's called the speculative term, mentioned her only to make sure that she's not representative. I mean, this was my feeling. So, in his presentation, his presentation of your work was in a way symptomatic of an anthropophatic approach. Yes, that matters, but let's see why it doesn't matter for the entire term. At least that's my reading of his presentation.
No, I don't think that he was, you know, concerned with history or future history, because it was too early to speak of any history of speculative feminism. He was interested in non-Marxism, and these were the only two texts which were available to him, and he actually had to access Laruelle, whose text on non-philosophy was not translated into English yet. Through my work, so yeah, he sort of used it as an auxiliary to, in his attempt to read Laruelle and his version of Marxism. So I'm not Marxist, I'm not non-philosophy. So, you know, I think that, you know, please do attention to the work. It's just that, you know, he simply doesn't have a concern of your work or Michael O'Rourke's work, or simply feminist concerns. He's more or less indifferent to feminism, so this is maybe why you're reading it.
Well, I guess this is where what I just said explains part of the reaction of people like Bedotti, in a way, because even when I'm trying to defend people who are not necessarily engaged with feminist concerns in speculative philosophy, I also somehow slip into, you know, the standard, resort to the standard critique from a feminist point of view. Yes, the gender matters, but not in a way in which you could model an entire theory. So this was the sense in which I refer to the way Nick Sernicek was referring to your work within the book. And here I don't want to go into the discussion on why Isabel Stengers is the only woman who is actually a female writer in the book, because it wasn't my intention to do that. So maybe before actually I continue, I have chosen two segments that I thought would be funny and interesting to exemplify up to a point what I mean by disembodiment. I first show a little segment, then I will read, and then there is another segment that I wanted to show. The first one is really short, but the second one will come a little bit later. And these are the two segments are taken from Ghost in the Shell, which is this Japanese manga, which is rather I don't know, too philosophical sometimes. Is the color gonna get better? So there are within the entire series and within the full feature movies, there are numerous occasions of cybernetic, how to say, apologies of disembodiment, I would say. And I chose these two segments to sort of expose this contemporary symptom behind this embodiment. And I will, I think, in the course of my presentation will become clear, I will do my best to become clear, that there is a connection between the contemporary imaginary of this embodiment in the cybernetic point of view and discourse, and the philosophical history of this embodiment as one that disembodies the female body and the female subject. There is a connection. This is also something that I'll deal with later, but because I'm really, really interested in the history of this, I wanted to just play a little bit. This is a segment from one short speech.
People fusing with a net.
After my experiences on the peninsula, I saw things more deeply. I found an aura that was full of contradictions, exploitation by the powerful, a structure that had grown corrupt. But what disillusioned me most was that people took no responsibility for anything. Even though they hadn't created anything for themselves, they understood nothing. When the masses come across information they agree with, they immediately internalize it. That's how they control them. When people feel no sense of responsibility, no matter what the unintended consequences of their actions, that makes very poor use of the net. My revolution is also an act of revenge on such people.
Revenge?
I've had a totally prosthetic body ever since I was a child, so I've constantly felt a sense of disparity between the mental and the physical. I wanted to abandon this crippled body and paddle out onto the sea of the net if such a thing could be done. The Asian refugees gave a man like me a reason to live. They told me that my artificial face was handsome and flattered me by saying that my ghost could be seen in it. That was the first time I realized the spirit and body might be inseparable, and I was able to think of myself as an actual human being, as if I were made of flesh and blood. But when they come across information that suits them, they get swept along the path of least resistance, just like everyone else. I suppose that in the end, humans are designed to follow the path that is easiest for them.
So, have you planned to carry out your revenge?
I will grasp the memories and the ghosts of those who are linked to me and take them into the net. If a nuke is dropped here, they will lose their physical bodies, but they will gain the chance to undergo a forced evolution.
What are the odds of them being able to retain their individuality in the net?
I can't be sure of that. But as pioneers, they may evolve into a new kind of being who can enlighten those left behind in the base, constantly making them aware of the superstructure, in exactly the same way that humans have felt reverence and awe towards spiritual beings since ancient times.
That is your revenge and offer of salvation for those who you let down?
Yes, although I think of it as a revolution. I see that you're fully prosthetic too. And you must have felt the doubts and fears caused by the disparity between body and spirit, just as I have. What do you say? Will you come with me?
There is, of course, the other dimension of social antagonism here, which is nice, but the point of showing this was before I go to my presentation of philosophy's work. The point was to give a contemporary fleshing out of what I call the problem of disembodiment, and here it's substituted by the idea of the cybernetic virtual body and what is called the ghost, and the idea that there is a net. It's not that different from what's happening in the Matrix. There is a network where you can just upload the consciousness and do away entirely with embodiment. So, Katerina actually knows pretty much better, I think, cyber discourse from a Laruelle perspective, and you also wrote about it in your last book on Marx and Laruelle. This is also one of the reasons why I thought it's interesting to go there. So, notwithstanding what was the particular situation in which I think her work is situated in the so-called speculative term, I think it's something more than a symptom. It reveals that there is a double burden in treating embodiment from a feminist perspective. So on the one hand, there are fears of renaturalization and resignification of gender from within feminism. On the other hand, attempts of renegotiating embodiment from both within and outside feminism get sidelined with either feminist revisionism or anti-feminist traditions. So I'm going to just discuss now the philosophical practice of what's happening lately, and I call it speculating gender, as seen in the framework of Kolozova and Menon. Madhavi Menon published a book last year that I think approximates in a way what Katerina is doing, but through appropriation of the philosophical view. So I'll try to show that the real problem with feminist philosophies of gender pluralism lies in resuscitating the notion of embodiment, but via its verse, which is disembodiment. Of course, the main point of disembodiment is to be, if it is resuscitated, is to be a useful tool for feminist poststructuralism. The big question is it a useful practical tool that would say something about protection of subjectivism? It doesn't have any political So, in this part, I'm just going to say briefly that what is at stake is what I already mentioned about the category, the old notion of the one, which is a Platonic notion taken up and developed by the Neoplatonists, to the point where we can say that there is an instance in the cult of disembodiment in the early stages of Plato's reception. So I think what Kolozova does is providing a convincing case by identifying the general paradox of feminist poststructuralism. And the paradox is the following. The limits of the subject and its construction, the way it is constructed, these limits they make manifest an outside. And for an example, I would say that we could study Lucy Rigaret's notion of the L square. And this outside serves the purpose of subject construction. But for postmodernist philosophies, as well as feminist poststructuralism, this outside belongs to the domain of the nonsense. It doesn't make sense because it is not a reference to any reality. And this is why, this is a quote from Kolozova, it deserves not a theoretical consideration, insofar as it would only assume the status of the unthinkable real. The paradox reveals that feminist poststructuralism does away with the real at the expense of subjectivity's arbitrariness. Unlike this hegemonic feature of feminist poststructuralism and trying to underline a shift in the thought of or from the real, in feminist poststructuralism, Kolozova says that everyone writing under speculative realism shares the conviction that, I quote, they identify limitations to thought or discursivity precisely in the alleged limitlessness of thought proclaimed by most modern postmodernism, which, to put it more bluntly and shortly, means that people who have identified with the particularist perspective of postmodernist or feminist poststructuralist philosophies have invested in a notion of limitlessness, which borders with the idea of the nonsense of reality. So nothing is real, everything is a similar term. This allows all sorts of production of subjectivity that would flourish, etc. It's a familiar trope for everyone immersed in this kind of philosophy. So to achieve something different, what Kolozova calls a unitary subject or subjectivity, what she does before that is explain how feminist poststructuralism, I'm not going to go through this part, how feminist poststructuralism has produced something called non-unitary subject. To achieve something different than that, one has to claim more or less explicitly that this unthinkable real, the philosophically deferred meaninglessness of postmodernism, is founded on the same decision on character as that of Eurocentric philosophy. So I have to make a pause here and explain that. Now, to the extent to which Kolozova's reformulation of feminist poststructuralism is based on Francois Laruelle's non-philosophy, the move that she does is to explain the feminist poststructuralism too as a philosophy of difference gets caught in what is called philosophical decisionism, which is taken from Laruelle. And by this, Laruelle means that there is always some sort of subjectivist, okay, this is a very crude formulation, but some sort of subjectivist blind spot from which one can represent a universalist point of view and reduce all fields of knowledge to the to subjugate all fields of knowledge to philosophical reasoning. So again, this is a very crude formulation, but basically the philosophical decisionism would mean something like that philosophy is, you know, the old Platonic formula, the reigning discipline above all else. And so the problem here is that while feminist poststructuralism has a certain allergy towards such theoretical posture, there is a way in which it has also allowed itself to speak from a certain authorial position that will be identified as philosophical decisionism. And even though feminist poststructuralism criticizes follow-centric philosophy, it could be criticized as reproducing certain features of follow-centrism. And this happens when feminist poststructuralism has its own hidden terms of application. And Kolozova exposes the set of terms that do this work. So there is an approximation of postmodernism and philosophical decisionism which is articulated. And for this reason, postmodernism can be seen as a continuation of philosophy's production of transcendence of the one, here in the guise which pretends for righteous darkness. And here I will present to you, I will show you the second video, which I think is much better explained what I've tried to capture so far. And then I'll try to switch to the second part, which is about Madhavi Menon. So the second video is actually not, it's not a, it's the second video is not actually from Ghost in the Shell. There are shots from Ghost in the Shell, there's footage from Ghost in the Shell, but it's actually a fan video, and this was also somehow funny and interesting to me that there are other people who have been so immersed and so enthusiastic about uploading minds and getting disembodied and, you know, being able to get away from your flesh and stuff. They will produce a, you know, a philosophical discourse on a Japanese manga. You know. And what I was just trying to explain as arbitrariness and meaninglessness of the production of subjectivity is, I think, very nicely captured. So this video is a bit longer. I suppose it's better to just watch it. And then I'll continue. I hope the sound is okay.
Thank you.
could somehow change the world from here?
Yeah, sort of at first.
And how do you feel about it now?
I'm not blazing with satisfaction or anything. But the truth is, it all ended for me the instant I shared my memories with you. At that point, my work was done. I figured that you'd probably be able to run with it from there.
Of all the... You're a hell of a liar, kid. I clearly recall you didn't want me involved.
I'm sorry, but the minute you share and synchronize all your information, you lose your uniqueness and become absorbed into the unconscious maliciousness of a third party that has no motive, or perhaps into the will of someone who does have
one. Are those your words based on what you gained from hard-earned experience?
Yes, and the fact is, you yourself play the role of a laughing man copycat as well.
Well, I have to admit, it was a fascinating phenomenon. At any rate, what was your underlying reason for triggering such a huge event in the first place?
To you, everything that's happening in the world appears phony to be something other than what it is, right?
Is that J.D. Salinger?
Yes. When it comes to cyberization, I'm pretty much the shining example of a poster boy. Save for at the very least, I would have felt terrified at the thought of contracting cyber-brain sclerosis. I'll tell you, it was a simple piece of mail I stumbled across in the net that began this whole thing. What I found was a blackmail document that had probably been sent to Serono Genomics. It was armed with a thesis that was a comparative study of the inadequacy of Serono micromachines versus the effectiveness of the Moderna vaccine.
Then the original laughing man was the person who offered it?
You can put it like that, I suppose. I am the machine that reveals the world to you as only I alone am able to see it.
Zina Bertov, he was a Russian filmmaker, wasn't he?
Yes. I was kidding myself by thinking it was my personal mission to prove and circulate that information, vital data I alone had happened upon.
Failing spectacularly, the pure innocent mediator grew dejected at the base nature of the social system and he turned mute.
Yes. It was because of that I became the vanishing mediator. Just like an author whose existence is emphasized by the fact that he rarely puts out any new words for publication. In other words, by disappearing, it acts as a regulating medium for the dynamism of the social system. Per sociological theory, it ultimately vanishes, leaving no trace of its presence inside or outside the system.
Frederick Jameson, I believe.
Yes. And no. Masachi Osawa, too. Even though I was familiar with the words, I didn't believe it until I saw it with my own eyes. Who knew that copies could still be produced despite the absence of permission? If you had to give a name to this phenomenon, what would you label it?
It would be standalone complex.
Yes, it's the standalone complex. From the start, the very nature of our current social system has contained the mechanisms to trigger such an amazing occurrence. Personally, however, I feel this marks the beginning of a new era of despair. What's your opinion?
I don't know. It's impossible for me to say. Although I have found one thing capable of restoring your individuality after all your information has been synchronized.
Oh, really? And what's that?
Everyday human curiosity.
You're right. You know, that's something that never occurred to me. I think my brain has already started to harden.
How are the yields of Serono? Japan micro-industries has apparently been blackmailed by the notorious laughing man.
Rehashing on disembodiment, the virtualization of human flesh, which again is a continuation of a much older narrative that I started with, the much older narrative of male reasoning that identifies with disembodied flesh. I will continue with a little bit several comments more closely and then switch to Menon. Kolozova contends that behind the very play of identitarian differences lies non-unity. And in Menon, which is interesting to the point of compare, she actually calls it non-fixity, not non-unity. So that is apparently an interesting paragraph. And this non-unity stabilizes dualistic thinking, which emanates towards a kind of axiomatic dismissal of any unitary subject. I quote, the assumption that there is an instance of unity doesn't exclude the presupposition that there are also instances of non-unity, end of quote. By underlying this, what is demonstrated that is that the main question is one of post-structuralist dualism, or what Katerina calls inflexible rigidity, according to which we continue to assume that the multiple is the truth of the one while refusing to acknowledge the converse. So the present non-convertibility of the multiple and the one is derived from the axiomatically positive non-unity of the subject. Kolozova sets out to prove that there is a way to reintroduce the convertibility of the one and the multiple, which, strictly speaking, is not even convertibility, if I get this right. As this is grounded in Laruelle's understanding of unilateral duality, an understanding that posits a singular and non-communicable relation to the real. So just to pause here for a little, according to Laruelle's theory of the real, we don't have access to the real, it has access to us. I mean, this is the most simple way, the most I can simplify it, I guess. So he calls this relation between the real and the world of the humans, unilateral duality. And if you will, the real, the instance of the real is something we have access to, something we don't have access to, but we would say it has access to us. It's a much more complicated theory, but I don't want to go into the discussion of the theory of the real. I'm just using it to flesh out the points that Katerina has been. So only through this Laruellian theory of the real could the post-structuralist political consequences of non-unitary subjectivities can be preserved. It is only by dissecting feminist post-structuralism from a certain outside, in this case through Laruelle's notion of philosophy, that all the outside can be positively restituted and the inside of post-structuralism can accommodate what is called the tethic posture of thought. Only then the project of the gendered subject from a realist perspective is in effect transformed. So this is what concerns me, how to transform an ethic. This is the whole point of Katerina's work, is how to transform the subject of feminist post-structuralism in a way that makes it easier. And then I will skip many things and go to my presentation of Menon, which is based on Badiou. So probably the only thing I want to add at the very end on the part of Kolozova's work is that what I found interesting is that there is an engagement with the notion of the one, but not from a historicizing perspective, probably, not from a perspective of critiques, new Platonic philosophy. And this is the part where I jump in. So just to underline that she isn't doing this. I took this part of making a sort of philosophical anamnesis of the notion of the one through non-philosophy, well, and the major problem with resuscitating the feature of the notion of the one is its quality of indifference. This is what really sticks to me, that the notion of the one is indifferent, and in Laruelle's terms, it would mean that, and Laruelle's and Kolozova's terms, it would mean that, while in the Neoplatonic universe, it's ineffable, and from the non-philosophical perspective, it's what was the exact quotation? It's infinitely effable. So there is a reversal of the entire notion of the one, which has, I think, different consequences. Madhavi Menon published a book last year, which is called Indifference, which is basically a book on queer theory, which is generally a feminist queer appropriation of the philosophy of Alain Badiou. And that's really weird and new. And pretty much nobody has known this, other than the journal that came out in which but you used the journal in which you have a publication as well, I think. Right?
Yeah, it's the one we
edited. No, the one by using feminism. A journal by you studies.
Ah, yeah, it's few studies, but the pieces again, it's not on
the. No, anyway, I'm just
so
saying. It was a topical issue. Okay, so my non-general argument is very clear. It's developed in her introduction. Generally, her argument is the following, that embracing the universal doesn't ask for the sacrifice of the particular, but only indifference to it. Her analytical program is the following, I quote, I want to use universalism's theory to destroy our investment in difference as the basis of identity, end of quote. Her position in the general debate on universality and particularity is the following. While I will take as instructive the insistence on emptying out the universal, I am less tempted by the rush to then feel that emptiness. Menon suggests that the instance of Paul, but use reading of Paul, which is a figure that summarizes critique of democratic materialism, could offer a universal panacea for policing differences from by it being allergic to specificity. Under Badiou, an event is a horizon of theoretical possibility. Menon takes the theoretical possibility of Paul's event and its identity and translates it into a queer interpretation of eventual subtraction of differences. The subtraction is not supposed to affect differences. For her, a quote, universalism is now being resuscitated in the name of difference. And this is where I see an interesting parallel with what we're doing. So I think this is a remarkable claim. And should be compared to what you do, and this is what I'm planning to do in the article that I sent you. So we have to develop this part also. The main question is what would be the political gain of making difference to difference? She says that she states that her argument about indifference pursues no such gain, and still it is a political statement. This is why I think it's really very difficult to understand what's her political action. If a politics is modeled after indifference, then such project can only be useful for activism that denies the ontology of difference. Indeed, the author easily dispenses with ontology. She's happy with the conclusion that an indifferent political activism would challenge exclusionary structures. Hence, this is, strictly speaking, a metapolitical position and not an activist political. As if she hopes that first we should persuade people that universalism renders all differences unremarkable, and then we should do politics. She finds a somewhat convincing metaphor transportation to describe what she does by saying that indifference allows us to travel without asking for a visa to authenticate the legality of our desires. End of quote. So this is a sort of her way of implementing what I call a no-border policy of indifference towards differences. And this, I'm just going to discuss a little bit and go to the conclusion, the implications of what she does and how I think this Badiou influence version of taking up the category of indifference that I see in the and try to parallel with the indifference of the one through Laruelle and your work. I just want to juxtapose these things and see what of the two versions is more politically useful. That is to say, go again to the question of the political usefulness of disembodiment and indifference for feminist culture. And the different arguments of Menonic's philosophical value lies in a theory of desire, which brings closer to the world of poetry. On this account, I quote Menon, ontology is always a fabrication that uses desire as its crutch, end of quote. Regulating desire, of course, relies on an ontology of desire. Here, Menon offers a parallel between universalism and queerness, as they both defy the limits of embodiment and the overflowing of desire. But this parallel seems to imply that queerness gets dangerously closer to disembodiment. And this is my problem with her argument. There is a point where Menon seems to confuse superabundance, which is a bodily term, with disembodiment. Namely, when she states that the universal queerness of desire doesn't need a physical body. And she states that the universal queerness of desire doesn't need a fixed body to make the point that we should be indifferent to difference, which would allow us to make a non-identitarian point. At this point, her indifference argument is too close to somatophobia. And this is the problem of feminist philosophers, that all such perspectives that try to speak from a position of nowhere are always already bound to the somatophobic tendencies. So without the limitations of embodiment and fixed bodies, queer universalism can indeed be indifferent to difference from her point of view. Queerness and universality meet halfway in the ontological impossibility as horizon or self-identity. Impossibility is the common denominator for both, as nothing can manifest ontological wholeness. If Menon's presupposition that particularity is no universal is somewhat banal, her original twist is that the singular quality of a difference is the non-fixity of the particular. This is again an interesting parallel to your work. She implies that politically, non-fixity gives political mobility to social movements or groups organized around desire. Embracing non-fixity is the same as translating the indifference towards difference politically. Simply, desire is not malleable to ontological emulation of differences, but it is itself a ground for non-ontology. So she's not proposing the theory of ontology of desire. Its potential lies in its worst political quality. It's being indifferent to bodies and colors and genitalia, the last thing was a quote. So instead of ontology of desire, queer universalism offers indifference to ontology in general. In short, the politics of indifference is sublimated in what it doesn't do, ontology, and what it disavows, embodiment. The universal organizing power of queer universalism is simply, and this is not the original point she's making, it's mode of refusal. It's a very familiar political trope, but she just makes it from the point of view of indifference and differences. So this is basically what interested me in this presentation. I think the text that I gave is much more developed, and here I also presented something that people have heard. The part on the mind. So I didn't include it in the text because I'm still working on it. So maybe just to wrap this up before you reply, my interest was to see to propose two versions of resuscitating a notion of disembodiment that is productive, that could focalize the point of so-called point of nowhere that is not somatophobic. And one of the ways I wanted to do that was to show the work of Menon in the view. My personal perspective is that the Laruelle version of what you're doing is more convincing, for the simple reason that there, I developed this more in the text that I sent you, that but you and is first of all somebody who's doing philosophy, the second of all, is somebody who's proposing actually a strong, self-aware version of philosophical decision, and he's proud of it. I don't mean if you think of you from a Laruellean perspective of the critique of philosophical decision, he's a proud philosophical decision maker, so to speak, right? I think this sort of self-congratulatory philosophical decisionism. Of course, it could be politically productive, but it's too orthodox when it comes to the problem of somatophobia. So this whole presentation, of course, was not to dismiss the version of indifference that Menon and Badiou do, but it was most juxtaposed with Laruelle and you, and what you do with and through Laruelle. And what I'm gonna continue to do with the dissertation is basically I take your version, I guess this was already clear, of enacting and trying to think about the importance of the indifference of the notion of the one and how it offers a universalist perspective of non-metaphysical, non-totalitarian version of universal subjectivity, as you put it. And for matters of posterity, maybe I just want to finish with one thing. I think it's just we shouldn't forget that this particular theory that you're developing and that has, I think, already has repercussions is coming from our region, and I think it's important to be self-aware of our places, people who make knowledge and produce knowledge. And yeah, I guess this sums it up. So any comment that you have would be very interesting.
I don't know, first thing, I think we should sort of set the record straight. I wouldn't blame Nixon and Jack for marginalizing my work, because if we try to recollect how this entire history came into making, this history of the so-called speculative realism turn, it took place prior to that book. It took place in the internet, and it, the word spread most rapidly, precisely through several blogs, among which Speculative Heresy, run by Nick, Alex Williams, and Ben Buller was also
a contributor.
I'm not sure. He has he had another one. But I think that he also contributed at some point to that one as well. So I think that, in fact, I was one of the rare, maybe the only one there, put on that map thanks to them. I'm the only one, perhaps, from this part of the world. The question is whether I really belong there, not just me, non-philosophy or Laurel studies. The person who introduced Laurel into speculative realism, Ray Gracier, has taken his distance from the term itself. Laurel never embraced it, so maybe we cannot even speak of any marginalization, maybe, you know, that there hasn't been any co-belonging between the two strands in the first place. Perhaps there is some marginality we can talk about, and through that comment we can move to the second I had on periodontic. Perhaps my impression is that there is certain reception which is gratifying at least to me. I believe that there is some echo there, some responses. There is some debate that the work has. Or that book, particular book, has stirred, and I am pleased with it. What is a bit frustrating and feels like a sort of marginality is that I don't see much reception or reaction from the feminists, in fact. So the only response, let's call it a reception, there was certain reaction and an attempt to include this discussion I opened precisely by Rosie Bregotti and Iris Van Toyn and the Utrecht School of Liberal Arts, Philosophy, Feminism, Humanities. So, it was precisely Rosie who was pretty open to these ideas. And I would say to the discussion, of course, he pursues a different path. But I would say that she is the only one, actually, from this great philosophical figures who has moved on from sort of would we call it, I don't know if it would be the right term, but sort of a stalemate, an aporia created by the paradoxes of post-structuralism, precisely through insisting on new materialisms, new materialisms. I think that she has moved toward the possibility of new universalism. So maybe that is the only reason feminist philosophy where we see this move. What I find, so this was just to, sort of, be honest about certain people and the relevance of their work and their reactions to my work, I find. As for the question of universalism, you raise here, and this disembodied attempt to establish a possibility for universalism through disembodiment, I agree with you. It's completely problematic, according to me. I'm even surprised, actually, to hear that the path would be, that would go beyond the body, the path of this queer universalism. I believe that actually it is the body which is beyond morphism, gendered morphism, that could be the grounds for certain universalism. A body beyond anthropomorphism, beyond the binarity of the two morphs, gendered morphs, could provide materialistic grounding for certain universalism in terms of queer study or queer theory, and which would be beyond identity. Actually, it is the gender dialectics which keeps us trapped in identity politics, the dictate of particularism, and disables, this possibility of a certain queer universalism. We are also in need of feminist universalism. We are in need of other forms of political universalism. Through Laruelle and the Count of the Real and through Marx and I think that I have made an attempt. I don't know if I have succeeded. I have made an attempt to provide certain theoretical grounds or philosophical. We can call it philosophical, although it's non-philosophical possibility of any universality or for a discourse of universalism. Which is it's not oppressive toward particularities. it's not oppressive toward, what is oppressive actually is reducing particularities to identities. What is oppressive according to me toward the particularities is the disregard for the materiality of the reality. What is oppressive is the barring of their possibility of access to universality or universalist discourse or discourse which operates in terms of universality. Where I find similarities, although there are all sorts of differences, as you pointed out, all those that you mentioned, the key ones between Laruelle and Badiou, the one thing I find they share and is very relevant actually in resuscitating certain post metaphysical, what's called universalism, is the relevance of the real. The real as, you know, the determination of the last instance, the conditioning of the real, and also of discourse, of thought, and so the real, and the other thing actually, the status of universality in both of them. If we really go into oversimplification, I just skip many chapters that need to be referred to and elaborate, if I may permit myself to simplify the whole thing, I would say that both of them insist that thought, theoretical thought, any thought, is always already universalist. And feigning not to be universalist or not to have a universalist claim is actually the first, the primary, the originary lie, let's say the grounding lie of identity politics, philosophical discourses that center around identity politics, or as I said, I may have been too harsh, but it is turning into some sort of a tyranny, this identity politics. And also it is very reductive and disregards many relevant aspects. Let's forget realism if we're not interested in realism. Let's focus on the material. Let's speak in materialist terms, that they disregard the material. So all the relevance of the material. So the universalism is indispensable right now for feminism, for queer, for politics, first and most of all, and it is also something which is necessary in order for us to move beyond certain status, or okay, it's not a status of the entire field of philosophy, but of certain tenets of philosophy, which are becoming really obsolete, which are indeed operate right now as this self-sufficient narcissistic fables of philosophy of itself, which would be a Marxist and a Laruellian project perhaps, but I do believe that it can be turned differently, and other authorities can be involved, but I do think that the entire field suffers from this sort of atomism of certain sort, and we can move beyond them only through certain universalisms, which have to be reconceptualized, of course. We cannot go back to the old ones. So that would be my question.